I'm standing at one of the most heavily militarized borders in the world, separating two countries that have technically been at war since 1950. This is the DMZ, or demilitarized zone, a roughly 150-mile long, 2.5-mile wide buffer zone that has divided North and South Korea for more than 60 years. I'm gonna take you inside one of the most tense and dangerous borders in the world, where war could break out at any moment.
This is how you enter the Joint Security Area, which is a neutral meeting place inside the DMZ. When the two countries do communicate, it happens in this area, which is overseen by the United Nations Command. Before you can even enter the Joint Security Area, you have to sign this document, which says you're entering a hostile area and may face the possibility of injury or death as a direct result of enemy action.
I'm told not to make any hand gestures or point, but over there in the distance, you can see a North Korean guard facing us, and the demarcation line between the two countries is marked by that line of concrete over there. These two blue structures in the middle are where the sides meet for negotiations. Let's actually go inside.
The South Korean guards selected here must be tall and have black belts in martial arts. They stand guard in a modified Taekwondo stance, which I learned the hard way when I made a wrong move.
Can you cross over? No, sorry, I can't cross over. So this is the room where the two sides actually meet for talks. On this side sit South Korean representatives. And over here, I'm technically in North Korea. North Korean representatives sit over here. These microphones on the table are on 24/7, recording everything that's said. And over the years, officials have met here to discuss how the Korean Peninsula should be governed. It wasn't always the case that Korea was divided into two adversarial countries on the brink of nuclear war. So how did we get to this point? To really understand, we have to go back to 1910, when Korea was colonized by Japan and spent the next 35 years under its brutal military occupation. After Japan's defeat in World War II, the Allies kicked it out of Korea and then divided the country into two along the 38th parallel. The USSR took control of the North and the US controlled the South.
Then, in 1950, the Soviet-backed Kim Il-sung regime invaded the South to reunify the country by force and impose communist rule throughout the peninsula. That kicked off the Korean War, the first active military hostilities of the Cold War. Newly communist China sent soldiers to back the North, while the US led UN forces to defend the South. More than 2 million people died during the war.
And the US dropped more bombs and napalm on the North than it did in the Pacific Theater during World War II, a fact that North Koreans still haven't forgotten. The fighting ended in 1953 with an armistice agreement between the UN command led by the US and North Korea and China. And prisoners of war were exchanged here on this bridge. But there was never a peace treaty, which means the countries are still technically at war. And everybody here is very aware that things could turn on a dime and have devastating consequences. Life for the 25 million North Koreans living behind me means being shut out from the rest of the world with no safe option to leave. Attempting to defect by crossing this border is suicide, with its high voltage electric fencing and more than a million landmines. Those who have managed to escape have done so by taking treacherous journeys through the mountains into China. The DMZ is a scary place, but there's also a lot of weird pettiness that goes on over here. Behind me over there is North Korea's propaganda village that it built in the 1950s to show off to South Korea and possibly lure people from here over there. Although as far as we know, no one actually took the bait. But when South Korean villagers here recently renovated their houses in 2015, North Korea responded by repainting the buildings of their propaganda village to make them a bit more colorful. And when South Korea put up a large flag, North Korea responded with an even bigger one. And sometimes these petty games get musical. Right now you can hear South Korea blasting K-pop music into the North. And North Korea responds by blasting their own propaganda this direction. Both sides basically trying to drown each other out. This is a mock tunnel representing one of the four invasion tunnels that North Korea carved into bedrock. I can't actually show you the real one behind me because filming isn't allowed, but it's wide enough to allow tens of thousands of North Koreans to invade the South and actually reach Seoul. There's thought to be at least 20 more that South Korea and the US are still searching for. But the bigger concern now are attacks from above, namely North Korea's missiles and nuclear weapons. Today, there's a lot of talk about reunification, but what that actually means remains to be seen. Behind me is a statue expressing the hope of the two Koreas coming together. The Korean War divided families on either side of the border who haven't been able to communicate since. Only a small number of Koreans have actually been able to have brief reunions. The hope for coexistence is still here, frozen in time and put on display for tourists. We're about to enter the Dorasan train station, which is the northernmost stop on South Korea's rail line. It used to connect Seoul to Pyongyang during the Japanese occupation. This is the track that would take you to Pyongyang. From 2004 to 2016, there was a stop in North Korea at the Kaesong Industrial Complex. That's where South Korean companies manufactured products using North Korean labor, one of the rare instances of peaceful engagement. But the former South Korean president shut down operations after North Korea conducted a long-range rocket launch and a nuclear test. Today, a peaceful end to the ongoing war remains a distant hope, although most South Koreans want it. They tend to take a less aggressive stance towards the North than their American protectors, and they voted in a new president who remains engagement-oriented. The question now is, how long will this militarized buffer remain a physical and ideological barrier separating the Korean people from one another? Only time will tell.
The DMZ is definitely one of the most surreal places I've ever been to. Make sure you guys check out the next video in this series that looks at the role of the U.S. military in South Korea and the Koreans that are opposing it. And be sure to like, comment, and share this video, please.